I can't believe that I have the honor of welcoming you to the 16th annual Rose Sheinberg Scholar in Residence Lecture. It's hard to believe, isn't it, Jill? This program was created by Jill and Richard Sheinberg and the late Dale and Arthur Galston to honor Rose Sheinberg, who's described in the brochure. And the Sheinbergs had the wisdom to understand that they wanted to create a program that was controlled by students. And we set up a structure that does that. And I think the lecture has a different sort of character than there are lots of great lectures. Norman Dorson's here, who runs the Madison Lecture, a great lecture. But the Sheinberg Lecture is different. It's people working on the cutting edge of issues of race, gender, and class. And as you can see from the brochure, we've had some wonderful folks. So in addition to Jill and Richard and the Galstons, I'd like to acknowledge Jane Dalkert, who's not here, who administered the estate of her uncle Joel and contributed to funding the program. And then the student members of the committee, we have three 3Ls who've been working on this program for 3 years now, and we're going to lose, which is very sad. We could flunk them. I don't know, Hal. I think that they're escaping our grasp. Rachel Goodman, Andrea Nieves, and Julia Shekeloff. Did I say that right, Julia? No. Well, 3Ls, Alyssa Yass, a 2L, and Ben Locke, a 2L. We're looking for 1Ls. If you know 1Ls who'd like to apply, applications are due on Monday in Leslie Jenkins' office. The faculty members of the committee are Holly McGuigan and Lynn Liu, who I don't see here. Oh, there she is. And then, of course, Leslie Jenkins, who keeps us all on our toes in the back. Gara Lamont Marsh is the person that Van asked to come introduce him. I think Gara is for many of us, our favorite philanthropist. He's our favorite philanthropist, not just because you like philanthropists for obvious reasons, but before he went into that work, he was a civil rights lawyer, civil liberties lawyer with the NYCLU in New York and the ACLU in Texas. And he's a guy who knows public interest in civil rights and civil liberties litigation and makes wise choices as a consequence. And with that, I'm going to give you Gara.
Norman, before I introduce Van, I'm sure there's one aspect of Sylvia's introduction you'd like to correct. What do you think that is? I don't have a law degree. No. I hire lawyers. Anyway. The ACLU has a long principle of civilian control, which I have been an exemplar. So I have a little thing here. Thank you, Sylvia. When Sylvia asked me to introduce the Sheinberg lecturer this afternoon and said that Van Jones had requested that I perform the honors, I was flattered and honored to be chosen from among the legion of admirers and followers of this remarkable man. The nature of such an assignment is to put the speaker in some context for his audience, then get out of the way. So that I will try to do. When you're on the platform with Van Jones, you count it as one of life's great blessings that you get to go first, for afterwards, who cares what you have to say? I think it's customary to rattle off the bio of the person you're introducing while they wait, squirming and wishing they had given you the short version of their resume. All I will say about Van in this context is that he was born in Tennessee in the tumultuous year of 1968 to a teacher and a principal, attended the State University at Martin, and then went on to the Yale Law School. He apprenticed with the great Eva Jefferson Patterson at the San Francisco Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights and used his stint there to incubate and found the first of three significant and enduring organizations with which he has been affiliated, the Ella Baker Center for Justice. Van went on to help found Color of Change, a people of color focused and led online advocacy organization, and Green for All to press for environmentally progressive pathways out of poverty. All this visionary work and the passionate and eloquent voice that built its strength in Van along the way led President Obama to name him Special Advisor for Green Jobs last year. That gig is over, and now he's hanging out at the Center for American Progress and Princeton University way stations to the great next great thing that he will accomplish for social justice in this world. Now, I met Van a dozen or so years ago when he launched the Books Not Bars campaign at the Ella Baker Center. I was then at the Open Society Institute, and we were proud to be early supporters. As he has done several times since, Van was on to something important, something that connected apparently disparate concerns and movements. He and his colleagues realized that there was a deep and troubling connection between California's overinvestment in prisons and its underinvestment in education and opportunities for young people. The work he did in that period helped criminal justice advocates to take a broader view of the ecosystem in which mass incarceration operates, and helped teachers and parents and students to see the connection of their work in schools and communities to their brethren behind bars. I was impressed in my early meetings with Van by his modesty and generosity of spirit, and that has only grown as the years have passed and his stage has grown larger. It's that ability to connect, to lead us all to higher aspirations and higher ground, that made Green for All, which linked the traditionally too white and too middle-class environmental movement with more traditionally too marginalized groups working on the front lines to fight poverty and economic injustice. Van Jones is sometimes called a social entrepreneur, but that is much too small a term for him, too referential to those whose creativity is focused on making money. Instead, Van's creativity, energy, passion, and vision have been directed with increasing focus and intensity every step of his life on a different kind of capital, the vast storehouse of human capacity, potential, and love. "I see you and I love you, brother," Van said at the recent NAACP Image Awards, talking about Glenn Beck, the man whose tirades pushed him out of his White House job, a man whose name the rest of us can barely utter without a bitter hiss. "I love you and you cannot do anything about it," Van said. "Let's be one country. Let's get the job done." Van went on, "I have had 1,000 defeats in the past year, but I had one victory and it's the most important victory to me," he said. "I don't hate anybody, I'm not mad at anybody, and I still believe in the politics of hope." And because Van Jones has hope, our hope endures as well. To paraphrase what Jack Nicholson said to Helen Hunt in As Good As It Gets, "He makes me want to be a better man." It may seem strange to come to a law school, to introduce a lawyer, and talk very little about one L word, the law, and mostly about another, which is love. This is a setting in which John Paul Stevens' stirring dissent in Citizens United is more likely to be cited than St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians. But Van Jones is a man whose heart is full of love in the most profound and important ways, not the ways of Hallmark and Light FM, but the ways of the great religious traditions of the world. Without love, to borrow a phrase from St. Paul, our speech is no more than a noisy gong or a clanging bell. So ring that bell for us, my brother Van. All of us who love and admire you are ready to stand up, follow, sing, dance, get the job done. Ladies and gentlemen, Van Jones.
See, I knew what I was doing when I asked for him to introduce me. You might get the Pulitzer Prize for that kind of stuff. Hello. How's everybody? Worried about your finals? Yeah. I'm glad that you're here. And Gar, that was just beautiful. Thank you very much. If I could get a copy from my wife, I'd appreciate that as well. It's an honor to be here. Thank you for having me. Thank you for picking me. And whoever was trying to pick somebody else, you'll get them next year. And I want to talk about the green job stuff, but you know, we're all friends here. Many of you guys have heard a bunch of this stuff before. I want to put it in a different context. because as Gara pointed out, when I first started doing the work that I was doing in the Bay Area, there was a problem that I was trying to solve. And that problem was the incarceration industry that we were then and are now growing in our country. We have literally an incarceration industry, not a criminal justice system, but an incarceration industry where the profit motive has begun to infect the decision-making of the legislatures and sometimes even the judges. And I thought that that was an abomination and that we should do something about it. And so through tough, hard work, through the Books Not Bars campaign, we were able to actually make the case that if we're going to spend $120,000 per year per kid locked up in California, I'll say it again, $120,000 per year per kid, you can send three kids to Yale for the cost of sending one kid to jail. If we're going to spend that much money on kids to tear them down, maybe we would be smarter to redirect some of those dollars to actually building kids up. And as a result of that advocacy and some lawsuits brought by sister organizations, we were able to cut the California youth prison population by 30%, which is, you know, will always be, of all the things I get a chance to work on and do, the most important to me. And yet, doing that work burned me out. I, you know, like many of you who are into public interest, I was working 18-hour days, 19-hour days. It was constantly, you know, one meeting to one protest to one press conference, you know, after another. And I literally just physically, mentally, emotionally just burned out. And I had to try to figure out some way to take care of myself, as well as trying to figure out a way to make a difference. And it was in the search for some kind of healing and some kind of a renewed sense of meaning and purpose and direction that I discovered in the Bay Area, all this green stuff. And I don't mean the trees. I mean, there's this whole green economy that was beginning to emerge. I had been working in Oakland and Richmond and these tough places, and I crossed the bridge over to this place called Marin County. Has anybody here ever been to Marin County? Okay. For those of you who haven't, Marin County is not Oakland. It's maybe 50 minutes away in a car, but it's not Oakland. First of all, everybody in Marin County is happy, you know. you know, how are you, you know? What do you want? You know, and they eat this magical ambrosial food called tofu, which makes them very happy. And they have things over there we don't have in Oakland, you know, like salads, and, you know, it's a whole other thing. And I tasted the tofu, you know. I ate up the salads. I beheld the solar panels and the no-polluting cars called hybrids. And I was renewed. And in driving back and forth, from where I was living to where I was retreating and praying and getting healthier, I said, you know, why do I have to get in my car and drive all the way over here for this stuff? Why don't we have clean air and clean water and healthy food and all the good jobs and stuff right here in Oakland? Is this some kind of eco-apartheid, where we're going to have ecological haves and ecological have-nots literally within 10 minutes of each other? And I thought to myself, I had this epiphany, I said, you know, what we need for these young people that I work with every day is green jobs, not jails. Green jobs, not jails. And those four syllables kind of gave me my next mission. And I went all over the country, all over the Bay Area, trying to explain this. And I'm happy to report that I was uniformly derided and laughed at wherever I went. The idea was uniformly unwelcome because the people who care about jails don't understand why I cared about the polar bears. The people who care about the polar bears don't understand what they have to do with the prisons. And it's the whole thing was a big mess for a long time. But going on the road, talking to business leaders, talking to labor leaders, talking to environmentalists, talking to youth leaders, talking to students, I discovered something in our country. I discovered that there's a beauty and a pent-up desire to see something dramatic happen in a new direction. And between 2000, when I wrote my first piece called Green Jobs, Not Jails, 2003, I gave this first speech. By 2005, I got a chance to do a conference, run a part of a conference for the United Nations on the subject. And then by 2007, we had legislation signed into law by George W. Bush called the Green Jobs Act as a part of the energy bill, 2007. Speaker Pelosi championed it and George Bush signed it. So bipartisan support for a new direction for the U.S. economy. And the problem, again, I was trying to solve was that I felt we had this military-industrial complex. I kind of went from fighting trying to come up with an alternative to the incarceration industry to trying to come up with an alternative to what I call the military petroleum complex. This kind of axis that runs from, you know, kind of Texas through the Pentagon and then overseas that kind of determines our energy policy and therefore a lot of our job policy, climate policy, et cetera. I felt rather than fight it, let's have an alternative, green jobs. And just as we were getting some momentum and things were working out and everything was going well and, you know, it seemed like maybe we might be able to turn a corner, the economy collapsed. The whole economy, not just the green economy, the whole economy. And so the work that I was doing to try to grow a part of our economy in a green direction suddenly became much more important to me. And so I want to talk with you about the last economy that we just had, which sucked and which tanked, and the next economy that we're going to have, which will be neat and beautiful. And the way I want to talk about it, because the questions will be more fun, the way I want to talk about it is to just describe the last economy and in contradistinction to the next economy and give you some ideas about how we can begin to use clean energy, green jobs, you could do it with anything, we'll just use clean energy, to begin to bridge over to where we're trying to go. So why did the last economy suck so bad? It would be if I was an economist, I'd probably have a better way of posing that one up. But what was wrong with the last economy? I would say five things. In the last economy, we were focused, say the last 30, 40 years, we were focused more and increasingly more on consumption rather than production, on importing rather than exporting, on credit and debt rather than smart savings and thrift like our grandparents, on unraveling good common sense rules, so-called deregulation, rather than enforcing and strengthening common sense rules. And then lastly, ecological destruction over ecological restoration. Let me hit those five again. Consumption rather than production, imports rather than exports, debt and credit rather than smart savings and thrift, unraveling common sense rules rather than strengthening them, and ecological destruction rather than ecological restoration. Well, what was wrong with the last century's economy and certainly the economy that just crashed? That's the economy that just crashed. That's the economy that sort of is on its back with a wheel spinning and people trying to get out of the car. That's the economy that just crashed. The economy we're trying to build will fix all that stuff. So let me talk to you about, in concrete terms, how we can actually turn that corner by using energy policy as one of the, not the only one, but as one of the key levers. Number one, consumption and imports kind of go together, but you guys know the story. I mean, some of you guys may have missed this, but we used to produce stuff here and export stuff here. And then somebody got a brainstorm and came up with this great idea that we didn't have to produce stuff here. Both parties. Yeah, we don't have to produce stuff here. We'll let other countries produce this stuff, and we'll just buy it. Think yourself, well, how long can you do that? Well, don't worry about it. We'll have a new economy. We'll shop online. You know, we'll go to the mall. And so the icon for the American economy goes from being the factory to being the mall, and we just start consuming like crazy. The idea that you could do that forever was sold to us pretty aggressively. And yet now, I think this past month, we had a $39 billion trade deficit. $39 billion with a B, trade deficit, just last month. That's the difference between how much we are buying from abroad versus how much people are buying from us. How do we get back in a posture where we're producing stuff and exporting stuff rather than importing stuff and consuming stuff? One way is smarter energy policy. We have, right now, a big chunk of our trade deficit has to do with importing all this energy and importing all this oil. But we have a Saudi Arabia of wind energy in our country right now. We have a Saudi Arabia of solar power in our country right now that we're not using. When I say a Saudi Arabia, what do I mean? I mean not just in our plain states, but up around the Gulf Coast, off of both shores, we have the ability to produce gigawatts of clean, renewable energy. We have a Saudi Arabia of solar power right here in the United States, not just in the Sun Belt, but on rooftops across the country. If we want to start, we want to stop importing and start exporting, what we would do is have a renewable energy standard or a renewable energy goal for our country, where we would actually get a chance to produce the wind turbines, the solar panels, and all the other equipment that's needed to tap all that energy. Now, what would that do? Well, first of all, right now, there are people who are sitting in places like Indiana, Ohio, Michigan, who are some of the most skilled workers in the world, and they're sitting idle. I mean, people who are machinists, people who know how to make cars and trucks and all those things that we take for granted. And don't anybody tell you these are lazy people. Oh, these lazy union guys, you know, something wrong with them, these lazy union people. That's what's wrong with the big three. No, those are some of the best workers in the history of the world. First of all, they make cars. You can't make a car. I can't make a car. He's like, sure I could. I could make a car. They have machines. The machines make the cars. Let's be clear. If you and I went into one of those factories with those machines, we would not make a car. We might make a hubcap. It'd be a little warped, and that would be it. We're talking about some of the most highly skilled workers in the world, and they're sitting idle. Well, we have, when you talk about wind turbines, for instance, to tap all that wind energy that we've got, each wind turbine has 8,000 finely machined parts in it. I didn't say windmill. Sometimes people slip up, politicians, they say, oh, we need more solar panels, we need more windmills. It's like, no, we don't, actually. We don't actually need more windmills. It's not like, you know, 1800s in, you know, Holland, you know, we're talking about. Wind turbines, as much steel as in 26 cars. Imagine Boeing-level engineering, okay? A jet engine in the sky that can turn a breeze into raw power, okay? And we need literally thousands of them. And if you, from a global perspective, hundreds of thousands for us to begin to transition to a clean energy economy. Why don't we turn our industrial heartland, our so-called Rust Belt, into a green belt and produce all those wind turbines for us and for the world? You could produce a bunch of them in Michigan, take them right out of through the Great Lakes on big boats all around the world. And you would be reducing the import of oil and expanding the export of American technology and putting our industrial workers back to work. See? Now, you say, well, that's impossible. It's not impossible. The simple way to do it is just to have a renewable energy standard or a renewable energy goal, where we say in the United States we're going to have, say by 2030, 25% of our energy will be renewable. The minute that we set that goal, the government wouldn't have to spend a penny. Private capital would come flooding in to the market to say, well, really? For real? I've got a guaranteed purchaser and more every year through 2030? And you would be able to jumpstart a whole new set of industries. That's not pie in the sky, right? So you got to do that in way more sectors than just energy. But you could go from being a net importer of dirty energy to being a net exporter of clean energy technology with one change of legislation in Congress. debt and credit. I said, consumption rather than production. I said, imports rather than exports. You can fix that. You can begin to fix that just by tapping into our natural resources here and exporting. Debt and credit. Now, I don't care what anybody here says. If your grandmother saw the difference between your credit card bill and your savings account, you would get a spanking, or you get sent to timeout, or whatever is culturally appropriate. But you would be in trouble. Okay? Why? Because that generation, the World War II generation, their savings rates were high. They weren't happy to carry around a bunch of debt. But you and I lived through a period of time where you couldn't open up your mailbox without credit cards flying out at you, right? Like, here. You wind up with like a pile of credit cards, just offered, 0% this or whatever. You go, must go to mall, You just have to kind of go and rack up all this debt. Well, you're already beginning to see those numbers move back in the other direction from the point of view of the savings rate in the U.S. going up, which I think is overall a good thing. But there are other ways to think about conservation and thrift. And, all too often people talk about, environmental stuff and jobs policy, they think this is only for liberals. It's only for progressives. It's only for Democrats. But these are common sense, deeply shared values that cut across a political perspective, political spectrum. And one of the things that we should be conserving, conservatives, one thing we should be conserving is energy. Because we're not only wasting money, we're also wasting energy. And that's another green policy that can begin to move us into the right mindset. For instance, the average American home right now is wasting 30% to 40% too much energy. The lights are on, the insulation's not right, the windows are old, and so we literally have energy pouring out through the cracks and the crevices in 100 million American homes. 100 million. Well, there's a program, how do you fix that? There's a program called Cash for Calkers, or Homestar, that would let us do something quite remarkable that conservatives should love. It's the most fiscally conservative approach to this problem you could possibly imagine. If you think about making a building, a home, more efficient, you take the same dollar bill, you tell our friend here, you could be a good worker. You're not working right now. We're going to put you to work weatherizing homes, retrofitting homes. So we're going to give you a dollar. That dollar just cut unemployment, right? As soon as that worker stands up, walks across the street, that dollar just cut unemployment. But that dollar is just getting started. These energy efficiency dollars are the most humble, hardworking dollars in the history of American politics. Because when you get to that house and you start to put in those new windows, you take out the old boilers and furnaces, you start putting in all that new insulation, you start retrofitting that home, energy upgrading that home, you also, that same dollar that cut unemployment just cut someone's energy bill, okay? But it's still just getting started, because most of the time, just down the street someplace, there's a coal-fired power plant working overtime, trying to heat and cool all these leaky houses. Well, if you cut the energy bill by 30%, you just cut the strain on that power plant by 30%. Which means you just cut pollution by 30%, which means you may have just cut asthma by 30%. And that's the same little hard-working dollar bill that just cut unemployment, just cut an energy bill, just cut pollution, just cut asthma, is still not done, because now that homeowner will enjoy those savings forever, and so it pays for itself. Right? So you got all those benefits for free. Why? Because you turned wasted energy into wanted jobs. Now, there's actual legislation called Homestar, which just got introduced today, that can actually begin to make that happen and begin to make conservation a value for us and put us in a position where, as environmentalists, we aren't always going around telling people, please spend more money on my product, right? That's what environmentalists often do. If you want to be an environmentalist, what do you have to do? Spend more money, right? I want to get a car. Well, you got to get a hybrid, but it costs more money, right? In my community, that really doesn't work. You go to people and say, you got to buy a hybrid to be a part of my movement. They're like, I ain't got bus fare. I can't get in the subway. Like, this is not a movement for me. Well, this gives us a chance to have an environmental movement that says, no, we're actually not asking you to spend more money. This is an environmentalism that will help you save more money and earn more money. See? And it's practical. And it begins, again, to deal with this question of having a consumerist, wasteful economy. Number four, unraveling the rules versus enforcing the rules. You know, I want to say a couple things about this. One is, we got beat up really bad, progressives, all through the 90s, opposing all this deregulation stuff. And we were going, oh, you dinosaurs, and blah, 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 and it's this whole new economy, and you guys don't know what you're talking about. And you know, I remember you know, the protests against the World Bank and IMF and all stuff, you know, about globalization, but also about deregulation. And we got beat up really bad. And what happened was, there was real wisdom on our law books from our great-grandparents who came through the Great Depression, who came through all that pain and suffering, who saw real human beings in our country literally starving, who saw incredible industrial capacity literally wasted, who saw all of that and put real wisdom in our law books. And, you know, it had names. It's not, you know, the Glass-Steagall Act, you know, to try to keep our banks from acting like, you know, casinos. And in 1999, both parties agreed to just erase that wisdom, to rip it out, ball in the garbage can, throw it away. We don't need it anymore. We're smarter than our great-grandparents. We're going to do it our way. And 10 years later, every single thing that our great-grandparents were trying to prevent came to pass in this awful way. And I think that we need to stand up as progressives, but also just as common sense people and say, hold on a second. Right? Hold on a second. This drumbeat, this mantra that, you know, the only thing the government's doing is standing in the way of good stuff is not true. It wasn't true for our great-grandparents or our grandparents. It's not true for us and our kids. And so as we begin now to reintroduce and strengthen common sense rules, I think we need to be loud and proud about it. Because, see, markets work. If you want to solve a problem, figure out a way to unleash market forces on it. You know, figure out a way to get a stampede of entrepreneurs and innovators and inventors to attack that problem. That's the way that you solve problems at scale. You unleash innovation. But markets work according to rules. And right now, our rules are wacky across the board, certainly in the energy sector, which I'll talk about. But they're wacky across the board, and they're not enforced. And so if you want to see the best of the market system, you also have to have smart government with smart rules and the ability to enforce. And this is the moment to come back to that basic wisdom and to be loud and to be proud about it. And I think that our banking, our friends in the banking system, you know, have so bitterly disappointed the American people. Because last year, we stood up for them. Last year, in 2008, our banks would have been, all those executives would have been homeless, wandering around, muttering at you with a sign, asking for a quarter, literally. And you said, who are these people? And you said, shh, he used to be on Wall Street. You know? I feel sorry for him. That's where they were headed, okay? And all of us as taxpayers stepped forward and bailed them out and helped them back up. The American people rescued the American banks last year. But this year, the American banks have refused to rescue the American people. 2009, we rescued them. But in 2010, they are still throwing people out of their homes. They're still jacking up credit card rates. They're still making it tough for students to get loans. They're making it tough for bosses to get bridge loans to keep people working. And they are refusing to be partners to us in rebuilding America. Now, that is unacceptable. It's not only going to be a question from my point of view, of us reintroducing the wisdom of our great-grandparents and our grandparents to the financial sector, but also insisting that our financial sector actually perform better for us now. They actually do better and become better partners because they have our money. It's not like, you know, they have their money. They have our money. And if you have our money, you should be working to help us. But that kind those kind of problems aren't limited just to the banking system. Let me touch briefly on energy, because that's the point of my talk. You should be really angry about one complete failure of regulation, mainly because it's just not fair to you. If you, at the end of this talk, say, that was a very interesting talk, now I must go study for my finals, and you stand up, and you, as you're walking toward the door, notice someone approaching you from the left, perhaps someone rather cute, perhaps not. This is your life, I don't know. But for whatever reason, you don't want to offend this person. You want this person to think, well, you think to yourself, while I was listening to that guy talk, a film has accumulated in my mouth. I am concerned about my breath. And as you walk up the stairs, if you reach into your pocket, you can find, to your great joy, a piece of gum and pull it out and put the gum in your mouth and feel great self-esteem. This could happen. This isn't too far-fetched. And then as you're walking down the sidewalk with that little gum wrapper in your hand, you might inadvertently toss it over your shoulder into the path of a police officer. This could happen. And the police officer would say to you, "You! To you I must give a fine." Yes, university cop, so well-educated. "To you I must give a fine." And then you would say, "To me? Why must to me you give a fine?" You say, "Well, because you just littered. You can't litter. You can't pollute this campus. You can't pollute for free. If you pollute, there's a cost associated with it." And you would say, "Thank you. Thank you, officer. Thank you for giving me this fine, because you are keeping," well, you wouldn't actually say it, but society would say, "Thank you, because you can't pollute for free." If you had a small business, you can have as a key part of your business model, every Wednesday you just take all your trash and excess product and just throw it in the middle of the road and walk away. Someone would come up to you and say, you have to pay to have that hauled away. You can't just pollute for free. You can say, no, you can't make me pollute, pay for my pollution. If you make me pay to pollute, you know, it might mess up my business model. They're words for people who think that way. They're not nice words. You can't pollute for free. So why should the biggest polluters in the history of the world, producing the most dangerous pollution in the history of the world, big oil, big coal, the big carbon polluters, get to pollute for free every minute of every day forever? Because that's what they're doing. And when we say to them, "To you, we must ask for you, right, to pay. Cap and trade, carbon tax, something work with us here." We hear this hue and cry. "You can't do this. This is terrible. This is awful. You're going to destroy the economy." Well, hold on a second. The minute that we pass legislation, smart rules, smart regulations, common sense rules, common sense regulations. If you are producing pollution, you should pay for it. You create a huge market for cleaner energy. You drive private capital in a cleaner direction. That's the right answer in a capitalist society, is to create market incentives, price mechanisms to push people in the right direction by making sure people can't dump stuff that's costly off on everybody else and have to take responsibility. So the next time you carefully walk over to a garbage can and make sure you deposit your trash, you know, support the president and everybody else is trying to make sure that our big carbon polluters do the same thing. Last point, I said we would talk about consumption rather than production, and we did. Imports rather than exports, and we did. Said we would talk about debt and this whole sort of lack of thrift in our culture. We did that. Just talked about the common sense rules. Last thing, ecological destruction. You know, how many people have heard of the story of stuff? Just a few. Okay. Annie Leonard, genius, story of stuff. Check it out on the website. Buy the book. It explains this much better than I can or will even try to. But we're basically turning beautiful living things all around the world into dead products and trash much faster than the planet can restore those beautiful living things. And what I would say is that we have a patriotic duty as well as a deep spiritual responsibility to begin to reimagine the economy. And when I say we have a patriotic duty, I grew up in really radical schools. I did. I'm confessing this. Maybe they were madrasas. I don't know. But they were radical, man. I'm going to confess. I've never said this publicly. I'm going to say it. I'd probably get me in trouble again, but this happened. They used to have a stand-up, all of us, and pledge that we would fight for liberty and justice for all. Every morning. Liberty and justice for all. I mean, it was radical, man. I don't know what was going on. It was in the rural South, grew up in Tennessee. But it was radical, man. They didn't say liberty and justice for all except for those damn gay people. Liberty and justice all except for those damn immigrants. I mean, they didn't qualify at all. These are radical people. And then they would have us sing these songs, these really out there crazy songs, like America the Beautiful. About this beautiful country from sea to shining sea. This land is your land. This land is my land. We had to sing that song too, man. We were trying to indoctrinate us with something. My view is that if America is to remain beautiful, if that song's to be meaningful, that little song that we still have little kids singing, if it's to be meaningful, then we have to defend her beauty. We have to defend her beauty against clear cutters, against strip miners, against the poisoners and the polluters, including, you know, us in terms of stuff that we're buying and we're all a part of the system. But we have to defend her beauty. And a part of the re-greening of America is re-establishing the beauty of America. Some of the things are not talked about in the president's recovery package. Have to do with literally billions of dollars for land restoration. If we had smart, sane climate policy, not just our industrial heartland could come back, our agricultural heartland could come back. You know why? This is what nobody wants to talk about. The people who are standing in the way of smart, sane climate and energy policy are trying to keep three paychecks out of the pockets of rural Americans. Three paychecks. If we had smart, sane climate energy policy, if you had some land, rural land, first of all, you'd have an incentive to put, and you would put, wind turbines on your land if you could. Right? You have to have a smart grid to connect it and deal with all the intermittent stuff. Some of you guys know this stuff. But the basic point holds. A whole bunch of places where the land's flat enough to grow crops, there's some wind blowing there. And you could keep growing those same crops and put wind turbines up, and you would get a paycheck. And you do nothing but watch them turn, and you get a paycheck for $5,000 to $15,000 every year per wind turbine. You think that's good for red states? You think that's good for rural America? Number two, you could grow a smart energy crop. I'm not talking about corn-based ethanol, but you know, algae crops and others. And you have a paycheck coming from that. Number three, depending on what you're doing on your land, if you're smart about it and use advanced agricultural techniques, you could capture carbon in the soil sequester carbon in the soil, be a part of a co-op, and sell your carbon mitigation on the carbon market, and get money for that. Three paychecks for rural America. This president's trying to get to them. As good for red states as anybody, probably better for red states than anybody. Right? And you have an incentive to re-green America, because planting trees, you can get carbon credit for. Restoring old fallow land, you can get carbon credit for. Right? So if we are going to live up to our patriotic duty to defend America's beauty and have an economy not based on destroying America's beauty, paving over America's beauty, chopping down America's beauty, strip mining America's beauty, but in fact restoring America's beauty, right, then we need a climate bill. We need carbon reduction, and we need a climate bill that lets us have that kind of an outcome. Now, I say all this stuff because Gara pointed out that I have a tendency to think about connections. And I do. I do. I've got a chance to go all over this country, both as a private citizen and as a representative of our government. There is no lack of beautiful people in both parties, beautiful people in red states and blue states, who want to see America be strong in the new century and to lead in the new century in a good way. And often, people like us, environmentalists, you know, we talk about sustainability, that kind of stuff. I say only one thing about that. If you go up to somebody and you tell them you are for sustainability, they know one thing about you. You went to college, right? Because nobody talks like that. But if you say that you want to make America stronger for the long term, and you will work with anybody to get there, including our energy companies, including people across the aisle, to get us there, my experience has been, despite what you see on TV, my experience has been that you'll be met with open hands and open hearts, and we need to get the job done. Thank you. Well, you know, there I tend toward, I have a view about this, which is I think that we've got to think about our energy problem more as a question of national security than a question of just sort of, energy is a very interesting commodity. You don't think about it when you have it, right? As long as the lights are on right now, nobody's thinking about it. You only think about energy when you don't have it. The lights go off, now everybody, the only thing, it's kind of like oxygen, right? In the human body. You don't think about oxygen as long as you have some. And so your oxygen policy might be somewhat negligent. You might not be thinking about it too much until suddenly you've got a shortage of oxygen. Then suddenly it's all you can think about. Then once you get it back, you think about something else. So our energy policy has been that way too. But I think that in the new century, given how much competition we're going to have from our friends in Asia for non-renewable energy resources, from an economic security point of view, from a national security point of view, we don't want to go from importing dirty energy from the Middle East to importing clean energy from our friends in Asia and skip the jobs in the middle and be just as dependent on China for lithium batteries as we were on the Middle East for oil. And so I think that when you, the argument I make all the time, energy is special. Energy is special. And when I think we make big mistakes with energy when we only look at, to your point, comparative
economics of the moment and don't look at the long-term security of the country. And I think that's an argument that has to be made. I think it actually has to be made by different messengers. I don't think that I'm the right messenger for a lot of this stuff. Frankly, I don't think a lot of environmentalists are. I would love to see more generals, right? More veterans standing up and making the case, and you're getting to see some of that. And I think that progressives have to be less squeamish about, who we are willing to support in terms of their voices. There are places that I can't go, but there are very few places that our veterans can't go. And a lot of our veterans get this as well as anybody else. And I think that's gonna be an important part, not just the message, but the messengers.
I'm gonna ask people to both identify yourself and use the mic, because we're recording.
My name is Sofia Kalantzakos. I'm a global professor at Environmental Studies at NYU. And I was a member of the Greek government, and I worked in labor and pensions, so I'm really interested in your talk. But I would like to say, why is it that America, which is so powerful and is leading in so many ways, is so far behind following the European example? Because Europe is leading and is making this transition by having specific limits as to having renewable energy by 2020. Percentages and, deadlines and guidelines and transition to green jobs. Thank you.
Well, it has to do with the politics of big oil, big coal, our utility companies. You know, we're a special kind of a place in that regard. And, but I also think it has to do with some of the failures on the part of people in our movement, the sort of, the greening of America movement. I think that we don't do a good enough job. I think we've done a much better job, and certainly if you look at, the past, 2 to 3 years, we've been able to break out of this. But we still have the perception, there's some elite consensus that's now been formed that moving from a waste and burn drill and burn economy to an innovation-based clean tech energy economy can be good for good, and can be job creating and wealth creating as well as good for the planet. There's some elite consensus there, but you can go to states that are run by Democrats that have Democrats in the Senate, and public opinion is not there yet. And so I still think that we've got a long way to go to build community level consensus that this is good. And then the other thing, of course, is anything that's dislocating means there's going to be new winners and new losers. So we often like to talk about the new winners, but our opponents can talk about the new losers. And that's also a political problem.
Thank you for a very a wonderful talk, really. My name's Natalie Jeremijenko. I'm a professor. I run the Environmental Health Clinic. And I work on redesigning environmental systems. My two questions are actually about the technical issues that are involved in really thinking about where and how policy should reinforce innovation, specifically because we know scientifically that the most valuable ecosystems for sequestering carbon are wetlands. And there's no carbon credits for wetlands. There's no even effort towards carbon credits for wetlands or the reconstruction of wetlands. Over 60% of them have been degraded in this country, 95% in California. And there's not even, that's not part of the policy discussion. Secondly, a big technical issue about the design of distributed local power production systems, which are not smart grids and which don't sacrifice 60 to 80% of the energy that in hybrid power production is, maybe we can't afford to design our grids in the ways that promote a kind of centralized ownership and billing system that is so popular and recognizable to, so the innovation with respect to designing environmental systems, socio-ecological systems that radically improve environmental performance might not fall into the templates of previous big industry systems and previous innovation incentives, and may require a much more science-driven and evidence-driven approach to the innovation. So how do we go about doing that, which is less about talking across and more about changing, you know, what's true?
Well, let me see if I got the question right. The second question is a question that's about how we're going to deploy the clean energy given the smart grid barriers. I got a little bit confused on the question. Just what do you want me to answer? Sorry. Yes. I got you. Well, just so everybody's kind of in the conversation here, there's a problem with all the stuff that we like, if you're people like me. I like solar panels a lot. First of all, they're pretty, you know. They go on your house, or they can go on a big farm. They look really great in campaign commercials. I like wind turbines a lot, you know. But the sun doesn't shine all the time, but you want to have your laptop plugged in all the time. And the wind doesn't blow all the time, but you want to be able to watch TV or whatever all the time. So these intermittent sources of power, on, off, on, off, on, off, require special storage and delivery, which we don't really have. Also, no matter what your power source is, nuclear, coal, natural gas, we waste a ton of it. And there are much smarter ways to kind of have essentially like an internet for energy, where we could, with a smarter grid, be much better at routing energy to where it needs to go and not wasting it. And then there's also this neat thing, if you had a smart grid and you were able to deal with intermittent power sources and you had some interesting legislation, you could have a very different life yourself at your house, right? You could get up in the morning, right, have a screen like on your refrigerator someplace, and actually know how much money you're spending right now on energy, which you don't. Right? I mean, think about this. We want everybody to save energy and not use energy, whatever. But you only have 12 in the whole year, 365 days, 66 on the leap year, you only have 12 feedback data points all year long. It's called your energy bill, right? You get your energy bill 12 times a month. It tells you how you're doing. It's not possible for you, and it just tells you, it's not telling you, it tells you how you did, right? Imagine if you knew right now how much energy you're spending, how much money you're spending for energy. Imagine if you could, hey, hold on a second. Somebody left the PlayStation on its own because we shouldn't be spending this much energy right now. If you want to know how much energy you're consuming, you've got to get up, you got to put your slippers on, you got to put your robe on, you got to go out the door, you got to go around the side, you got to look at a little brown thing, little dials are spinning, you're like, I don't know what it says. Then you got to go back in the house and wait for your bill. All right? So even if you wanted to, if you're willing to risk your slippers, you can't figure out how much money you're spending. And so here's something else your life would be great. If we had a smart grid, not only could you buy power off the grid, you could also sell power back on, right? Now you're a producer and a consumer. Now everybody gets to be a producer of energy. Wouldn't that be neat? Now who does that make angry? That big centralized power plant down there doesn't like to hear that. That big nuclear power station, that coal-fired power plant, that gas fire, they don't want to hear that at all. They don't want you to be an energy producer. They don't want you and all your friends, you know, finding smarter and smarter ways to milk more and more energy out of your neighborhood and drive your bill down more and more. They don't want you saying, ha, ha, ha. Right? I used to get an energy bill. Now I get an energy check. Where's the check going to come from? So at the end of the day, when people say, well, you know, these crazy, you know, socialist people and all these terrible, we're saying, no, we want more competition. We're the drivers of competition. We want more competition. We're tired of these big monopolies. We want to bust it up. Break it open. Bring in new technologies, new entrepreneurs. We want you to be one. Right? Now, it all sounds great. My friend was pointing out a bunch of technical issues, which we should just probably talk about offline because I can't talk about it well enough for the whole group. But that's the goal. That's where we're trying to go. That's what we want your life to be like. And that's how we want our energy system to work. And you asked a question prior to that, which was... Sure. Yeah, there's a big, if you guys get interested in this stuff, I mean, there's a big world of how we do the offsets, essentially. The planet doesn't really care where the carbon comes from or where it goes. It just doesn't want it all in the atmosphere, if you're concerned about global warming. And the reason to be concerned about global warming, obviously, is that life did this beautiful thing for us before we got here of sequestering all this carbon out of the atmosphere and tucking it underground. It's called little critters walking around and dying. Right? And so we have the same amount of carbon on our planet as Venus has on its planet, right? But Venus is 800 degrees, and we're not. There's only one reason. It's not because of the relative closest to the sun. It's because Venus has all its carbon in the atmosphere, cooking, and we have most of our carbon underground. And it's the broken bones of our ancestors, right? Under the ground. We call it coal. It's the blood of our ancestors, ancient blood of our ancestors under the ground. We call it oil. That lets life happen up here. We have a society that's based on bringing up the dead remains of our ancestors, burning it without ceremony in our power plants and our engines, taking death from the ground, fueling our society with death, and now we're risking getting death from the skies. Right? That's the truth of who we are as a civilization. We're a vulture culture, living off the energy remains of the dead. The option that we have is to turn to living sources, the living sun, the interaction between the moon and the earth, which creates the tidal waves and weather patterns, and to actually capture what's living and live in integrity with available resources. That journey from a society fueled by death to a society fueled by life, that's the path that we're on. That's the path that we're walking. Now, we want to avoid putting more carbon in the air. We also want to pull more out. And your point is that the wetlands are doing that. Life is still doing that for us, still absorbing carbon, still capturing and fixing it. We want more life. We want more green life to fix more carbon, to capture more carbon. To your point, the wetlands don't have a lobby, short answer. And other offset gobblers and desires do. And you are right that we need more science-based decision-making on this point. Probably have, one more question? Two? You know what? I'll take questions, and then I'll answer them all at the end. That way we get all the questions in.
That sounds good.
Okay.
Okay. Jared Lode.
And that means the questions have to be short, though.
This will be really short.
Yes, sir.
Jared Lode, I'm a 3L here at NYU. In what direction should federal R&D policy go to support some of the changes you'd like to see in federal energy policy?
Couple more.
Hi, I'm Ben Locke. I'm a 2L. I was just hoping you could talk a little bit more about ecological apartheid and how you talk about that. What's your message when you talk about this in Oakland?
Hi, I'm Daniel. I'm a Wagner student here at NYU. I read all about the incredible work that Brahm Ahmadi is doing at People's Grocery, that LaDonna Redmond's doing on the south side of Chicago in terms of increasing good food access in underserved areas. I'm wondering what is keeping food, I mean, farming is the original green job, so I'm just wondering what is keeping food out of the discourse on federal green jobs legislation. Because I just read this report about energy use in the U.S. food system that USDA just put out, and it's pretty explosive in terms of the net increases in energy that our food system is causing right now.
Hi, my name is Anurag Gupta. I'm a TUEL, also a Reynolds Fellow in Social Entrepreneurship. My question is more about how we can use best practices from other countries and incorporate that within our everyday culture, such as unplugging all of our electronics before we go to bed every night, and composting all of our waste and recycling, making that scalable across the country as many countries in Asia and Europe have done. I would like to know your thoughts on that. Thank you.
Well, you got two last questions. That's fine. Or three? Okay, fine.
Yeah. All right. Peter Cohen. I was just wondering, instead of coming here and talking about this stuff, why don't you just go and create a business that does some of this stuff?
Hi, my name's Trish Cannon. I'm a second-year student at NYU Stern. And I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit more about setting this goal for our government in terms of renewable energy, and exactly how are we going to guarantee those payments to the people that, you know, create the new renewable energy, things like that.
Hi, my name is Adam Herling. I'm a 1L here. And I was just curious, I really like how you sort of bridge the gap, or the apparent gap, between the sort of anti-poverty and the environmental campaigns. But I was wondering how you might see that apply at the international development level, because it seems to be a sort of similar in some ways of attention with poor countries saying, you know, you're trying to foist onto us all these expensive environmental regulations and whatnot. And sort of thinking about, or just, I would love to hear from you if you have any ideas on how, you know, what sort of solutions there might be to that issue.
Good.
I think I'm last. I'm Alyssa Bell. I'm a 3L. And I wondered if you could talk about how we keep green jobs in America, given the, you know, fact that we've learned through globalization that other countries can do it cheaper.
Allegedly can do it cheaper. All right, well, let me try to run through some of these. And first of all, I know you guys are incredibly busy, and, you know, some of you guys are not only worrying about finals, but worrying about, you know, job offers and all that sort of stuff. So just the fact that you're here means a lot to me, and I appreciate it. I remember being in law school, it was 17 years ago, but it was. So some of you guys were, yeah. Don't tell me what you were doing 17 years ago. R&D policy. I think that we still need breakthroughs with regard to batteries. You know, storing energy is a big game. And the president was really wise to put $5 billion in the recovery package for smart batteries. The Department of Energy is moving that forward. So there was one thing that I would be focused on, I would say energy storage. Because I trust that if we get everything else right, people will figure out how to continue to make energy. In fact, as a human species, we've done a pretty good job. The problem is that right now we're stuck in the post-whale oil strategy, right? I mean, that's why we use petroleum. You ever ask, well, why do we use petroleum? Like, they didn't have petroleum in Jesus' time. Like, where did we come up with this petroleum stuff? Well, we used to use whale oil, then we ran out of whales. So they said, well, there's some gunk in the ground, we'll use that. And we've been doing that for 150 years. So then somebody like me comes along and says, geez, can't we do a little bit better than the gunk in the ground? I mean, the gunk in the ground post-whale oil strategy, can't we come up with something better than that? I got an iPod. I'm confident we can come up with something better than the gunk in the ground. And you know, it's like, oh, this guy is strange. No, I just have confidence in the human family. But we're good at coming up with energy sources. Energy storage is tougher, and we're stuck with the periodic table that we've got. So it takes a lot of scientific innovation to drive for answers there. Food, you know, the two big drivers, they're two big drivers of change, I would say food and fuel, right? If you, because those are two things that everybody uses every day, right? The other two would be waste and water, right? Because everybody uses water and it produces waste. So if you want to figure out how you transform the system into a way into something that's healthier, stronger, produces more jobs, better for everybody, you got to deal with the food and fuel, waste and water. I focus on fuel, energy, but they're all linked, and we could talk about the ways that they're all linked. They're just way better, smarter people than I am on food policy, and also the farm bill and the energy bill are two completely separate pieces of legislation in our system, go through different committees, have different lobbies, and the whole deal. So people like yourself who are visionary enough to see where they come together will have a 10-year walk to try to embed more food policy in the energy bill and more energy policy in the farm bill. And at some point, we would hope that they wouldn't, you know, that common sense would win out. But that's not where we are right now. So the best practices from overseas, you know, part of what you raise, and I don't have a good answer for this, but culture changes, like stuff that's not compelled by law, are, you know, those are harder to even think through in a society like ours, where it's not like everybody is sitting in front of the same TV set at night, and one good person can come on and make the case, or everybody's listening to FDR on the radio, you know. People are, you know, they're looking at screens all day, but they're not looking at the same stuff on them. So trying to drive culture change is much harder, and it requires much more innovation and creativity and many, many more angles. And so I'll just leave it at that in terms of, you know, at least a barrier to getting that done. Eco-apartheid. You ask, how would I give this speech in Oakland? I would not give this speech or any other speech in Oakland, because they've been hearing me say the same crap for 10 years. But when I used to give speeches in Oakland about this stuff, you know, I talked about making our communities better, stronger, and healthier. See, the key to having a politics that works is to focus on things that people already care about. Work, wealth, and health are things that people who don't have those things care a lot about. The problem is that most environmental politics are designed by people who they're not lacking in work, wealth, or health. So they tend to talk about things at a level of abstraction that may not resonate. But for communities that don't have work, wealth, or health, we got an answer for them. It's called the green economy. Gonna produce way more jobs, way healthier way, create new opportunities for new entrepreneurs. And that's you know, that's the case that I make. And I would argue that for anybody to take this very seriously, if you're talking to people who already have a lot of opportunity, people like us, elites, you got a big audience of people who got a lot of opportunity, talk to them about the crisis. Tell them, right, we're all gonna die! We're baking the earth! The ice is melting, you know, right? Why? Because they may be moved by that. They might say, geez, I better do something. This could mess up my stocks, you know? And they may take action. But if you're talking to people who already have a bunch of crisis, they don't have a job. They don't have basic security. They're struggling day to day. Don't come and tell them about more crisis.
Yeah, you think you're suffering there, Mr. Homeless Guy. Wait till I tell you about the Arctic ice circle. It's
like, I mean, if they believe you, they're just going to go kill themselves. It was like, There's, right? This is, tell the people with opportunity about the crisis. Tell people with crisis about the opportunity. Tell people with the crisis about the opportunity, about what we can do and how we need them, how we need their hands and their hearts and their communities to be a part of something beautiful. And that's what I say when I'm in places like Oakland. Internationally, we got tough competition from our friends in Asia, bless them. I do not want anybody as a part of the green movement to be China bashing, India bashing, and Asia bashing. Asia has hundreds of millions of people in abject poverty. They need to come out of poverty. It is a huge achievement for humanity that they're finally going to be able to do that. I would just want them to be able to come out into a green economy. And I want the same thing for people here. So the goal should be two things: to have a fair share of the global set of green jobs. We want a fair share of the global set of green jobs. And then secondarily, we want every American to have a fair shot at that fair share. And that comes in, you know, the anti-poverty, equal opportunity stuff. And there's policies that can get us there, but we're almost out of time. Last thing is, why don't I create a business to do some of this rather than talk about it? Now, you will note the fallacy, the either-or fallacy. Yeah. One can both start businesses and give speeches. So it's a false dilemma that you pose, and people who have the ability to should probably do both, and some of the best speakers on this are the ones that have started businesses. However, I'm not going to start a business to do any of this stuff because I would be a lousy business person, and I believe that the people who are great, I'm a social entrepreneur, you know, like you said, or whatever I am. It's not what I'm best at. And the great thing about this transition is that we need everybody's genius. There's a circle of honor that literally everybody can sit at, from the financier to the kid in the job training program to the environmentalist, all the way around. And we get a chance to celebrate each other's genius. And that's what I hope this movement will be increasingly about. Thank you.
Honestly, I can't remember when I've heard such grace and humor brought to subjects that are so serious and depressing. We're all grateful to you. I also want to just close by thanking the student groups who helped us organize them, particularly Jake Beneke and the social entrepreneurs who found an email for Van, which was a critical link. And thank you, and Gara and Van, for coming and giving us this wonderful, wonderful opportunity. There's a reception right across the hall to which we're all invited.